Hi everyone, I'm Attilio Baggio from the University of Cagliari in Italy, and today I'm going to speak about how to use enhanced sampling methods to improve the predictive power and the accuracy of molecular docking, and so describe in silico molecular recognition events. See, here is a list of a few references I suggest you take a look at if you want to understand which are the major challenges and the pitfalls and the current developments in molecular docking, virtual screening and related approaches. The outline of my talk is as follows. So I will briefly introduce molecular recognition and the theories that have been put forward in these years to explain and rationalize molecular recognition events. Then I will focus on molecular docking, which is one of the most widely used techniques to mimic in silico molecular recognition events. In particular, I will discuss how enhanced sampling methods could improve the predictive power of molecular docking. And in order to show you this, I will discuss four selected case studies, including a recent protocol developed in our laboratory. So coming to molecular recognition, with this term, we identify the formation of a specific interaction between two or more macromolecules, biological macromolecules that could be proteins interacting with other proteins or with nucleic acids, lipids, and molecules such as drugs, for instance, antibiotics, antivirals, and so on. And these macromolecules bind to each other to form a specific complex. So suppose you have a target protein that in principle could bind to different ligands, and in particular you can see here the binding site, the putative binding site of the protein, but only one ligand will form a stable complex with the protein, and so only that ligand will be recognized by the protein target. This means that that ligand binding to the target will show a higher affinity than any other ligand to that target. Molecular recognition is by far one of the most important molecular events in cells. So it is involved in all cellular processes, metabolic processes, pathogenic processes, and so on. And so the understanding of molecular recognition at anatomic level cannot be overemphasized. And this is important not only for basic research, but also for drug design. Indeed, if you understand how a drug and a protein, for instance, interact at a molecular level, you can hope to design new drugs with better properties and better activity in interfering with protein function. So, there are at least three main theories that have been put forward in order to explain molecular recognition events, and I will discuss them in the framework of protein-ligand interaction, but as you can imagine, all the concepts I'm going to present can be applied also in the framework of protein-protein, protein-nucleic acids, and so on. So these theories are the lock and key theory, the induced fit theory, and the conformational selection theory. So the lock and key theory is the first one that was introduced by Fisher more than 125 years ago. And in this theory, ligand and protein interact rigidly as rigid bodies. So they cannot undergo any conformational change upon binding. So you can already understand that this theory implies that there should be a shape complementarity between the ligand and the protein. So the interface should be performed in a way, and so the ligand can bind only to the protein that has a conformation matching that of the ligand. Okay, indeed, the lock and key model has been superseded by the model that we will discuss in a while, but the historical merit of this theory was to introduce the shape complementarity concept. So, only correct ligands, to repeat the concept, can be identified as the key, can bind to the keyhole, that is the binding site, in the protein, that is the lock. And another feature of the lock and key model is that the binding is always associated to a stabilization of the protein conformation associated to the binding. Unfortunately, the lock and key model cannot explain experimental evidence because protein binds also if the initial shapes, protein and ligand binds also if their initial shape do not match each other. And the first model that has been introduced to rationalize this fact was the induced fit model by Koshland in the 1960s. And in this model, basically, you suppose that the binding sites are flexible. So side chains can change their orientation in order to accommodate binding. There could be small changes in the conformation of the backbone, in the protein, and so on. These conformational changes in the induced fit model are induced by the ligand. So the presence of the ligand changes the conformation of the protein. You can understand that in this model, basically, you don't need the different conformations of the protein at equilibrium. You basically have to postulate one conformation of the protein at given conditions, and this conformation of the protein will be the most stable one in the absence with the, of interactions with the ligand. But when the ligand is present, the conformation of the protein will change, so there will be another state, that is the state B associated to the binding, and this state will be stabilized also in the induced fit model with respect to the state A that was preferred in the absence of the ligand. A problem with induced fit theory is that it can generally account only for minor to medium conformational change localized at the binding interface. And so another theory has been also developed that aims to explain also binding events that involve large scale conformational changes in the protein or in both partners. This theory is called a conformational selection theory or selective binding theory, and derives from the fringe landscape theory of the proteins. So briefly, one of the main concepts within this theory is that proteins are inherently dynamic also in the native state at equilibrium. So they oscillate around the native state, but they can also assume conformations that correspond to different states than the one that is most likely. And we have then an ensemble of states with different population distributions. And basically, the important thing in the conformational selection theory is that among the states that are sampled by the protein in the absence of any ligand, there is also the state that corresponds to the conformation of the bound protein, so the conformation assumed by the protein in the complex. So let's call these two states, for instance, A and B, and suppose that A is the state associated with the unbound protein and B is the state associated with the bound protein. So the ligand will bind to B, even if B is not the preferred conformation in the absence of high concentration of ligands. Okay, so you can see this in the free energy sketch on the left side of the slide. B is higher in the free energy landscape than A. But then the binding will cause a population shift towards the bound receptor structure. And this, in turn, will cause a redistribution that, of course, will obey the laws of statistical mechanics, and the underlying free energy landscape will be reshaped as a consequence of the increase in the percentage of bound-like structures in the pool of protein conformations. Now, it has been verified experimentally that all the distinct conceptual models that we discussed are exist. So, and in particular, they can coexist okay, in some binding, in some molecular recognition events. So there has been a huge effort to unify the molecular recognition description using both models. And one way to do this would be the following. Suppose that the first binding between a ligand and a protein is a non-specific, non-optimal binding. So, and in order to be so, it will not induce large conformational changes in the partners. So we can say that approximately this can be a kind of lock and key binding event, and this can be dominated by the solvent gain due to the removal of water molecules at the interface between the protein and the ligand. But then once the interface has been formed, the side chains and also the functional groups in the ligand can change their conformation, they can rearrange in order to optimize the contacts. And then this means that we are seeing an induced fit event. Then the formation of the complex will reshape the free energy profile, okay, and will alter the free energy barriers separating the different states and also the relative stability of those states, so forcing the increase of population, the increase in the population of states associated with binding. So the bound state will become more probable, and then we have a conformational redistribution, and which is actually a phenomenon that we just discussed in the conformational selection theory. Okay, now that we discussed the theoretical framework of molecular recognition, let's start to see how molecular recognition can be mimicked in a computer. And as I said, molecular docking is a tool that is used in over the world, in all labs in the world, to investigate molecular recognition in silico. It's probably the most used methodology to investigate this kind of events in silico. Molecular docking relies on a description of the so models of the ligand and of the protein. That means that we should have the structures of both partners and also a description of their physicochemical properties in order to describe the interactions they can form to each other. So, suppose we have a ligand and a protein, we call also the protein receptor, and then the next step is to identify a putative binding site on the receptor, and once we have identified a binding site that can be a region of the protein but also the whole protein, then we try to dock the ligand into the binding site in order to generate the so-called docking poses that are putative structures of the stable complex formed by the ligand and the protein. Each pose will be associated with a docking score that ultimately should mimic possibly the free energy of binding of each different pose. And of course, we expect that a reliable docking algorithm will be able, one, to find real structures of the complex, and not only this, but also to rank them on top. So, even if we find a real structure of a complex, but this structure is ranked as 100 or 100 or 150, then probably we will lose this structure while trying to refine the docking pose. Now, you can imagine how many degrees of freedom are involved in a typical docking run. So we have to explore all the rototranslational degrees of freedom associated to mutual orientation between the ligand and the protein. And more than that, we have to take into account for the flexibility of both partners, in particular for the flexibility of the protein that has generally a very large number of atoms. So you understand that it is impossible to exhaustively explore in a systematic way the phase space associated to to the formation of complex. And then, in order to address this issue, several algorithms of increasing complexity and computational cost have been developed over the years. And they are really many and can be classified in many ways. Here I will use a recent classification by Antunes and co-workers, which classify methods according to the way they treat flexibility, either partial or fully, or implicit versus explicit treatment of flexibility. And we have soft docking approaches, as you can see here, in which basically you reduce the van der Waals radii of the atoms in the binding site of the protein. You have selected docking approaches in which you allow selected side chains on the protein to change conformations in docking. Then we have ensemble docking algorithm in which we can use multiple conformations of the protein in order to account implicitly for flexibility. And on the fly docking, in which you change both the conformation of the ligand and of the protein during the docking run. In the last years, ensemble docking has gained attention and actually is one of the most used tools today to account for receptor flexibility in docking. In the simplest implementation of ensemble docking, one generates different conformations of the protein, and these different conformations are used to account for different shapes and volumes of the putative binding site, as you can see in the picture on the right side of the slide. Now, it is desirable to obtain conformations that are different from those present in the PDB database. Why? Today we have several thousand of structures in the database, and the rate of deposition is constantly increasing, but still there is a problem, because first the rigid targets are overrepresented because of the historical prevalence of X-ray methods to derive protein conformations. Second, compared to the druggable genome, still the number of structures in the PDB database is low. And third, we have a kind of redundancy concerning the chemotypes of ligands, because it happens often that we have structures of proteins with ligands that belong to very similar families, and so if we have to search for a different chemotype that can have an action on that protein, we are biased in some way. So, deriving, obtaining conformations from computer simulations is desirable, but is challenging. Why? Because as you can see from this graph, the extensive sampling of the conformational space in simulations is very expensive, in particular concerning the processes that are associated generally with ligand binding, that are, for instance, refolding events of some stretches of the protein, or side chains reorientation, in particular of side chains that are buried into the protein. These processes take microseconds to seconds to occur, and so you can understand that in simulations these processes can be hard to see. So, in other words, if you have a conformation of your protein that represents the unbound state for that particular ligand, or the pool of ligands you want you are interested in, if the free energy barrier associated with the transition from this conformation to the holo conformation, that is the bound conformation, is very high, then you have problems in sampling this conformation. Just to give you an example, suppose to have a barrier of 10 kcal per mole, and this is associated to, let's say, typical events that can occur on a time scale of a few milliseconds. Supposing that you are able to perform simulations at a speed of 1 microsecond per day, which is actually state of the art, and even a lot, depending on the size of your system, Well, you can hope to see events by simulating this system for at least 3 years. So you can understand that this is not feasible. And unfortunately, as I said, these processes are important either concerning the local rearrangements, as you can see in this example, in which you see a tyrosine that change conformations in order to accommodate the ligand, that is this one that you can see in the binding, or large scale conformational changes, such as domain, hinge bending or shading motions, okay, unfolding of protein segments that are in contact with the ligand, or refolding also, and so on. And as I said, neglecting these processes often leads to poor docking results. So how to cope with this? In the last decades, a lot of enhanced sampling methods have been developed that aim to improve the conformational sampling, and in particular to improve the conformational sampling of states other than those associated with unbound conformations of a protein, for what concern things we are interested in. There are a lot of classes of methods, and I just put this slide for your reference, and today we are going to see applications with three different methods that are metadynamics, accelerated molecular dynamics, and the T-Concord approach. Let's start with the T-Concord approach that was developed in the lab of Berdegrau. And these are the key references you can have a look at if you want to understand deeply the method. So basically, the method holds basically is based on a previous method that is called Concord, in which the interactions present in protein structures are translated into a set of geometrical constraints that can be compared to the building plan of a protein. In particular, the authors identify two main classes of interactions: the topological ones that include covalent bonds, angles, and so on, and non-covalent interactions such as H-bonds, hydrophobic interactions, and so on. These interactions are actually represented by distances between different atoms. So basically, you have a protein, you calculate a matrix of the distance between all atoms in your protein, and you define upper and lower limits for each distance, and the limits are based on the kind of interactions. So the topological interactions will have generally shorter lower variance in their distances, and on the distance between the atoms that are involved. So you define upper and lower limits, and you can see, for instance, here a construction plan referring to the H bonds present in the protein. You can see, for instance, in blue, the backbone H bonds formed. You can recognize the three helices, I guess. And the other colors refer to the backbone side chain and side chain bonds format. Once you have defined your restraints, you can use several techniques. The authors use the generation of random structures in particular to generate coordinates, and then you impose to those coordinates the satisfaction of all the restraints that you have defined in your building plan. In this way, you can generate a pool of structures, okay, that should represent oscillations of the protein around the native state. And the next step that was implemented in T-Concord was to sample conformational transitions between two states, for instance, between the APO state associated with the unbound protein and the OLO state associated with the bound protein. A key observation that was used to develop the Concorde was that the structural transition observed in the structural databases involved always opening of one or more edge bonds. And then one could analyze these transitions and predict where the unstable edge bonds are by estimating a solvation score on the sides around each edge bond. Why? Because it has been shown that the more wet is the site, the more likely is for a water molecule to attack the edge bonds formed between atoms of the protein, and then the more unstable will be the edge bond. So if we calculate the probability of having a solvation score in a range of values, we can define unstable edge bonds as those that have a value of the solvation score above a threshold that we can fix and validate. This then allows to identify the structural hinges in our system. Okay, and so you can see here as red sticks the edge bonds that are predicted to be unstable in the construction plan that we show in the previous slide. So those will be the points in which we will not put any restraint. So no, if we don't put any restraint there, the coordinates of those atoms should not satisfy the distance restraints between each other, and then we can hope to see larger conformational changes at those places. Then we can sample the conformational transitions, for instance, using essential dynamics, so analyzing the trajectory and finding the global motions associated with the protein flexibility. Here you see the conformational transitions that are sampled by T-Concord as a function of the projection of the trajectory on the first two eigenvectors derived from the covariance matrix of the trajectory. Here you see that we almost sample the conformational transition between the open for AKE, you see on the right side, and a closed conformation of the protein. You can already see an interesting point in this slide that we will discuss in a while, that if you add another experimental information, so the fact that this protein has been crystallized in presence of an inhibitor, you can focus the sampling in a more interesting region. So, indeed, the sampling of apo-to-holo conformational transitions can be further enhanced by implementation of other kinds of experimental information into set of restraints. In the example here, you see on the left side the open structure of a protein, and you see that there are four distances that are highlighted by red lines, and these four distances are also restraints, and imposing these restraints allows to sample the conformational transition towards the closed holo conformation that is shown in tan here in the middle of the slide. So the method ensures a sampling of functional motions, in other words, from apo to holo, means you are sampling functional motions of the protein, and you can see that if you use the Concorde in the presence of an experimental bias, you actually have a much better sampling. You can see this in this slide, in the graph on the lower part of the slide, comparing the red dots in which you have an unbiased application of the algorithm, and the black dots, okay, in which you use experimental information to focus the sampling in the right direction you are interested in. Now, Seliger and Groth in 2010 applied the T-Concord algorithm to sample conformational changes associated to ligand binding in a set of 10 proteins undergoing medium to large conformational changes upon binding. You can see in the last two columns that the RMSD calculated either at the backbone or at the binding site of the protein span values going from 2 to 7 angstrom, so a very large conformational change upon binding. And in addition to using T-Concord, in this work the authors exploited additional information in the form of biasing the sampling towards values of the radius of gyration that are compatible with closed conformation of the protein that are associated to ligand binding. So there is a bias in the generation of coordinates that derives from experimental information. Here is a sketch of the automatic flow that was set up by the authors. Basically, you have an iterative refinement in which you first generate conformations, then you dock the ligands using autodock Vina, and after a second refinement, you improve the binding description using a Rosetta ligand. So, without entering further the details of this protocol, in this picture are shown the 5,000 docking poses obtained for each system. You can see there are 10 systems as a function of the ligand RMSD with respect to the true experimental structure and the score. The lowest the score, the highest is the ranking of the pose. And you can see here that in 9 out of 10 cases, the holo-like receptor conformation was predicted using this methodology, and in 8 out of 10 cases the native-like pose was identified. You can see that only in the case of Gluco and in the case of Osmo, native-like pose was not identified. In the case of Algae and Gluco were not identified among the top 100 poses. So overall, the method is suitable to generate up to holo conformational transitions in a set of different proteins, and to improve then the description of molecular recognition events in the same targets. The second case study we will see today is an application of the so-called replica exchange molecular dynamics simulations. And also in this case, I list here the key references to understand what we want to speak about. The method works by performing multiple simulations that are also called a replica of the same system at different temperatures. Okay? And at the constant time intervals, you basically try to swap the coordinates of two adjacent replicas in order to improve the conformational sampling. You can see this explained very well in this graph that I took from a recent review. And in a typical setup, then what you do is the following. You try, you set the system of interest with the lowest temperature, okay? And that is the temperature of the ensemble you want to sample. Then you set the highest value of the temperature in a way to avoid disrupting the system you are investigating, but at the same time to allow for sampling of easy sampling of free energy barriers. So if you do so, you can see here highlighted by black lines the sampling of replicas among different temperatures. You can see in this graph you have more than 50 replicas, and each of them at a different temperature, and you can see that you basically if you are able to exchange the replicas with a good rate, you sample in a continuous way the temperature space, okay? And then you produce a good mixing of the conformations. Now, just a few words on the way the exchanges are made. Suppose you have a probability, a normal distribution for regarding the probability of each state in a, X, okay? And then if you choose the temperature in a proper way, and that means simply that you should allow the two systems to talk each other, the two adjacent replicas to talk each other. So that means that replica I should be able to assume conformations that are also assumed by replica I plus one. Then if you do so, you have an overlap between the distribution of states of the adjacent replicas, and they will overlap. And in this case, you are sure that you can get have an efficient exchange between the adjacent replicas by implementing a metropolis-like criterion for the exchange. And in particular, this is the criterion that one can implement in order to exchange two different replicas. So if you have two states, X and X prime, basically you will have an exchange between the two if the potential associated with X prime, that is the replica at lower temperature, is lower than the potential of the replica X. Okay, this because the exchange will be automatically energetically convenient. Okay, if this is not the case, then basically you calculate the probability of exchange by comparing a random number with the exponential of the delta factor that is reported in the equation you see in the top side of the slide. So by implementing this criterion, the important thing that you do is that you allow the replicas at high temperature to flow, to swap, to go down to lower temperatures. And this then will allow the replicas that are running at low temperatures to exploit conformations that will have never been exploited in standard molecular dynamics simulations. And another important point about the replica exchange molecular dynamics simulations is that while the trajectories are, of course, discontinuous, okay, in temperature, we will achieve Boltzmann sampling because we are implementing the Taylor balance. Actually, this is not necessary because recently it has been shown that the Taylor balance is not needed also for achieving Boltzmann sampling. Now, Oskutorp and co-workers used replica exchange molecular dynamics simulations in order to investigate binding to three different targets that are HIV-1 protease, cyclin-bound kinase 2, and androgen receptor. They compared the performance in ensemble docking of three different sets of conformations. One set of conformations obtained by collecting the crystal structures available for the three targets, another pool of conformations generated by performing a relatively short standard molecular dynamics simulation, and the third pool of conformations generated by performing replica exchange molecular dynamics simulation. And they used conformations generated in this way to investigate their performance in virtual screening experiments. Here are the details of the studies. Basically, you have a lot of structures coming from XA and from standard MD. Of course, you can take how many structures you want, and the same is true for replica exchange molecular dynamics simulations. Now, you generate a lot of structures, but when you go to perform docking using ensemble docking, basically the ideal setting would be to use the lowest number of possible structures while keeping the description of variations in the shape of the binding site as high as possible. And a way the authors implemented this was to calculate the so-called matrix of pairwise normalized volume overlaps at the binding site. How do you do this? Basically, you have a binding site in a conformation A, and then you can calculate the volume associated with the shape assumed by the binding site in conformation A. You can do the same for a conformation B of the same bending side, and then you calculate, after aligning the two structures, you can calculate the volume of the overlap between, so the intersection basically between the two bending sides, and you can also calculate the sum of the two volumes. And then you can define the volume overlap using this formula, which basically tells you that if this parameter has a value of 1, you have a perfect overlap, and if this parameter has a value of 0, you don't have any overlap. So performing a cluster analysis on this parameter allowed the authors to come out with only 4 clusters for each system and each structure generation protocol. Then they investigated how, before showing you the results from docking and virtual screening, I wanted just to show you this picture in which you can appreciate how replicas change molecular dynamic simulation actually, as expected, increased the conformational sampling at the bonding site. In the graphs, you see a distance that was chosen by the authors representing oscillations of the binding site. And you can see that the red graph that is representing standard MD has much lower oscillations than the distance calculated in replica exchange molecular dynamic simulations that are shown in green. However, with respect to X-ray, the results are system dependent, and in particular, in the case of the androgen receptor, the X-ray cluster features the highest shape diversity. In particular, you can see in the top row, X-ray, the C column, okay, you can see that there is a white lobe going on the up left side of the picture that was never found either by MD or by replica exchange MD simulations. But RMD is also able in some cases to be superior to the conformational diversity generated by X-ray crystallography. And this is the case, for instance, for the HIV-1 protease, in which RMD clusters feature the highest shape diversity among all the clusters found for this system. Then, once you have the clusters, you can perform docking and virtual screening. And in particular, to perform virtual screening, that means basically take a large pool of ligands and try to see which of them binds with high affinity to your target, you can use the so-called dataset of useful decoys, DUD, to provide active and decoy ligands. This is a very famous dataset. There are other datasets that have been developed over the years because it includes active compounds and also decoys that are not active. And so by docking active and inactive compounds, you can basically see how your protocol is able to rank the active compounds on top and then to recognize them as true active compounds for the target you are interested in. Here are some details of the protocol implemented by Hospital and co-workers. In particular, they choose as a parameter to evaluate the performance of virtual screening the so-called enrichment factor. That is the ratio between the number of active poses, the active compounds, in the top percent of the poses. For instance, A1% is the number of active in the top 1% poses coming out from the virtual screening experiment, divided by the number of compounds in the in the first percent of the dataset, divided by the total number of actives and the total number of compounds. To appreciate why this enrichment factor is important, you can compare in the graph on the right side of the slide the ideal curve with 10% actives in our compound database and 50% actives. You can see that if you have 10% active compounds in the dataset, in the ideal setting, those 10% active compounds should be coming out as first 10% among all the screened compounds. And you can see that an enrichment, a typical enrichment curve instead is between the ideal setting and the random random trial, in which basically you don't have any indication of which are the active compounds with respect to the decoys. Now, the authors in particular used the enrichment factor to evaluate how using an ensemble of compound of receptor structures is improving virtual screening. And in order to do this, you basically compare the performance of using an ensemble towards the average performance of using each structure composing the ensemble. So X-ray succeeded in all cases. You can see that, for instance, for the androgen receptor, you have 39 active ligands in the ensemble of 1% active compounds. And if you repeat the same experiment on the four structures that compose the ensemble and you take the average, you have a lower number. And the same is true for the enrichment factor, and this holds for all the systems, as you can see from the numbers reported in this table. REMD succeeded also in all cases but for the androgen receptor, and if you remember, the androgen receptor was the system in which REMD was not able to generate a shape diversity as good as the X-ray structure. And MD, standard MD, featured the worst performance overall. So the author shown also in this case that using an enhanced sampling technique actually improved the performance of docking and virtual screening. The third case we will see today is the application of the so-called accelerated molecular dynamics, that is an enhanced sampling, sampling technique implemented in the Mechamon lab. And basically, we are going to see an application done by Motta and Bonatti a few years ago. So in accelerated MD, you add a non-negative boost to the potential energy surface, but only when the system is sampling potential energy that are lower than a threshold E. In this way, basically, you only modify the potential when you are under the threshold, and you can, if you tailor properly your parameters, you can realize a very continuous curve of the so-called modified potential that you see in the equation is equal to the original potential above the threshold and to the potential plus the boost below the threshold, and this will allow the system to escape more easily from potential basins in the potential energy profile. How does this translate into improved conformational sampling? Well, if you have a shallower minima, you will be able to accelerate the rate of escape from this minima by a factor that in this case turns out to be equal to the exponential of the boosting potential. And then the estimated, the simulated time that you are going to reach in your simulation will be increased by a boost factor that is the average of this exponential. Two flavors of accelerated MD were implemented, providing two different acceleration levels. In the so-called single boost or dihedral boost approach, basically you apply a boosting potential only to the dihedral angles, okay, with the formulas that you see in the slide, while in the double boost or dual boost version, you apply both potential to the dihedral angles and another potential to all the atoms of your system. You see that in the formulas there are averages. in order to define the energy threshold above which you don't apply any boosting potential. And these averages are calculated from short unbiased molecular dynamics simulations of the system of interest. Motta and Bonatti applied accelerated MD to generate conformational transitions that will improve the binding of alloys to the alloys binding protein. As you can see from the picture, there is a very large conformational change seen in this protein upon binding of the alloys. And the authors performed microcycle long molecular dynamics simulations comparing the classical, standard, conventional, decoyled conventional MD to single and double boost accelerated MD. They performed a volumetric cluster analysis of the conformation generated using the volume of the binding site, of course, and then they performed docking. So before analyzing the docking results, let's see if and how accelerated MD was able to improve the conformational sampling of this system. You can see here the comparison between conventional MD and single boost MD, either in terms of distance, in terms of RMST from the holo conformation of the protein, and in terms of conformations associated to a pseudo angle and a pseudo diagonal angle that are shown on the right side of the slide, and in particular how the pseudo free energy basing projected on these two coordinates was expanded in the single boost accelerated MD. Although, as you can see, the holo-like conformation was not reached by performing even a microsecond long molecular dynamics simulations. So the authors also used double boost, extended the simulation by half microsecond, and in this case they were able to sample holo-like conformations of the protein. And the same was achieved with the double boost accelerated MD. This improved conformational sampling of the protein translated in improved docking. Indeed, you can see here that by performing a cluster analysis and choosing the number of clusters to be 10, the second cluster, featuring an RMST at the binding site lower than 2 angstrom, was able to generate binding poses featuring an RMST of the ligand lower than 2 angstrom. So, also in this case, enhanced sampling techniques were used successfully to generate conformations that are similar to the bound conformation of proteins, and this translated in improved accuracy of docking protocols. Okay, well, this is the last slide of my first part of the talk, and I will see you in a while for the second part.